Straight to the content, as always. So I promised you some new content once I got my renovations done. Got this bar top in, backdrop set. So here we go. Brian Shaffer. So Brian Shaffer was a 27-year-old medical student that went missing March 31st, 2006. And just like most cases that we cover here, it seems like it's actually going into the next day, April 1st. 2006, that's right, April Fool's Day. So, very intriguing case. I can see why this has everybody intrigued about it. The gist of the story, I guess, would be that a guy goes to a bar and never comes out. Sounds like a bad joke, right? But it's a nightmare. So, during my research with this, what I wanted to do was find out more about Brian. When you have any missing persons case, just like a homicide, but even more in a missing persons case, you want to know everything there is about that potential victim. So I have limited information. Just like in a lot of these cases, unless you have the police reports, and even then sometimes you don't have everything because they may not feel the victimology is as important as, let's say, I do. I mean, you really have to know what that person would do under any given situation. Now, it's not always a gimme. They're not always going to do that. Fight or flight. What would happen? In this case, what happens is Brian Shaffer, who's a 27-year-old, he's a med student, which right off the bat tells me he's pretty smart. More than likely, makes good decisions. However, that's not always the case. And when you couple in the fact drugs and or alcohol are involved, specifically, not this case with drugs that I'm aware of, but alcohol for sure. You want to know what they would do in any given situation and how they reacted before in situations. So in this instance, before we get into the specifics of a timeline, the general broad scope of things, he goes out with a friend and is bar hopping, returns to the first bar that they go to, which is called the Ugly Tuna Saloona. Very clever name, and then he disappears. Now that's not unlike a lot of missing persons cases that I've seen, but what is significant about this is there is cameras, and cameras capture Brian going into the bar and never coming out. That is why it's intriguing, and we'll get into the specifics of that. Yet I want to talk about the general overall victimology, knowing a person, what they would do under any given circumstance. So in this case, they had gone to several bars, him and his friend Clint. By all accounts, and that's hard for me to say because I don't know. By all reported unofficial accounts, he was intoxicated. And I say it like that because I didn't read it in a police report. I didn't hear it from a witness's mouth. Okay. These are newspaper articles. I'd like to know how intoxicated. And if he was intoxicated, how does he handle his intoxication? We all know people, friends of ours, that get intoxicated and they act like idiots. I know a state trooper friend of mine, we used to go out and he would be normal and then it seemed like in a second he would turn to, we'd call him mush mouth, because he just started like, he couldn't even understand him, he got so drunk. That's what I would want to know about Brian. And I don't want to know this from family. I want to know this from his friends who've gone out with him. I don't want to know it from Clint, and we'll get into Clint later. But I want to know it from other friends, high school friends. He got his bachelor's degree from Ohio State, I believe, before he started going to med school. I need to know how he handled his intoxication level and what that intoxication level was that night. So let's get into the timeline quick. So earlier on in the night on March 31st, 2006, so early evening, he goes out to a dinner with his father. He seems to have a very good relationship with his mother and father. Now, the twist to this, which is a red flag to me. Remember, this is different, but when I read police reports, anything that stands out to you, red flag, you're writing down. Go through the whole report. And then you go back to those things that stand out to you. They stood out to you for a reason, and that's where your investigation begins. For this, newspaper articles, a red flag to me was he was close to his mom and dad, and his mom had died on, I believe, March 6th, 2006, according to this obituary that I found. So you're talking 4 days previous to this? That's a red flag to me when it's a missing person, okay, for obvious reasons. He has dinner with his father, then he goes out with a former, I want to say roommate, at least a friend, colleague, by a gentleman named Clint. Now Clint and him bar hop. They start at the Ugly Tuna, which is a local college type of bar. My research into it shows that it was a shady bar, but hey, all bars are shady, okay, especially in a college town. I don't put any stock into that. Looking at the entrance of the Ugly Tuna and the upkeep, it seems okay. It's this normal college bar, okay? Nothing's throwing me off there. The location of it being in a second floor is a little odd to me, just because I don't think I've ever encountered that. It's almost like it was in a shopping mall area from what you see. I've never been there. I would want to go there if this was my case, obviously, and look around. But remotely, looking at aerials, looking at the photographs that I could see online, that stood out to me as well. Doesn't mean it's a bad thing. It stood out to me. You have an escalator taking you to the bar, much like you would see in a mall. So Clint and him start out there, and then they bar hop. And according to Clint, reportedly, again, you don't have police reports. I'm not hearing it from Clint's mouth, so I'm not 100% believing it. But what I read is that they did a shot at every bar. Not unusual, but it does play into his intoxication level. They meet a girl, one of, from what I understand, Clint's friends, Meredith. They, the three of them, then continue to drink and then make their way back to where they started, the Ugly Tuna. It is there around 1:15. Surveillance video shows them going up the escalator. By the body language that I see, and remember, I'm not believer in body language per se to tell somebody's guilt or innocence, but of human nature, I can certainly look at body language and tell whether there's an issue. You know, somebody's pointing their finger, yelling, someone's relaxed, shoulders down, moving around, talking. You can certainly see that, and by all indications, it looks like everything's okay. Going into the bar, that's at 1:15. At 1:50, Brian is seen outside the bar. Now, when I first hear this, I'm thinking outside on the street. And that's why you can never rely just on words. You have to go further. Outside the bar just means outside the establishment. They're still inside a building. And in fact, he's standing next to two security guards. Okay, that's something else that struck me. They're security guards. They're not plain clothes. They're not bouncers. They have uniforms on. He's talking to two girls right next to these guards. At some point, I seem rather quickly, they leave, and then he follows suit. And by leave, I mean leave the area. He doesn't go down the escalator the same way he came in, which I thought was the only ingress and egress to that establishment. I've come to find out otherwise. But he goes off camera, but it looks like he's going back into the Ugly Tuna bar. That's at 1:50. At 2 o'clock, so about 10 minutes later, you see his friend Clint and Meredith exit. Okay, they're caught on camera, so there's no doubt about that. He never exits that we know of. He's not shown on camera. They comb the security video and nothing. Now, the next day, he is scheduled to go on a flight. I believe it was to Miami with his girlfriend. It was a present from his mother, which obviously it meant a lot to him because she had just recently passed away. Dad had gone to his apartment and noticed nothing was missing. They didn't know he was missing at the time. Things, he wasn't answering his phone, and then it escalated, obviously, to the point where he was missing. And this is 2006, and he's never been seen again. So his car was there, his credit cards, the money, everything apparently was there. When he misses his flight to go to Miami, this was a planned event for a long time. Remember, his mom bought him this gift. So it was in the works for a while. He doesn't show. Therefore, people know something is definitely wrong. Then he's reported missing to police. And then the investigation gets rolling. So when somebody's missing, there is only, you know, a couple of, well, really, there's only two things that is possible, right? They're either dead or they're alive, usually, whether it's on their own merit that they go and disappear on their own to start a new life. What we must do, and as investigators, is start deducing, okay? Let's start with that. Let's not get into, well, he was killed inside the bar, he was placed in a garbage can, he blah, blah, blah. No, you don't start there. You start here with alive and ran away on his own accord or dead, foul play. Well, I think both have merit. And the reason both have merit, again, you go back to that red flag of his mom having cancer and passing away recently. Okay? So you have that red flag. He may have been depressed and wanted to start a new life and or suicide. But we're not. I don't want to get into that. I just want alive or dead. Okay? I think we could deduce, at least I am comfortable with what I see, and this, it could change my mind if I read the police reports and I see something different in interviews with people. But from his victimology, knowing he's a med student, he is an attractive, good-looking guy. He fits the bill for a med student, a doctor. He was athletic. He was a tennis star. At least he was very good at tennis. He was the oldest of two sons. He had a girlfriend. There is no indication to me that he would run away and start a new life. Now, people say, oh, he made comments on his social media that he would rather be on the beach and, you know, be hanging out with Bob Marley or something like that. Now, that intrigues me a little bit because that means that maybe, possibly, he would be an imbiber of marijuana, but that really doesn't do anything. Gives me a little bit of a feeling, but not one way or another. With his dad going over the next day and seeing his car there, nothing touched, I would be very confident in saying he did not make it home. You couple that with the surveillance video that shows that he didn't leave. So now it goes to possible to probable for me that he didn't leave the bar. Okay? Right now. So I think we can deduce that he didn't run away. Now, could he have suffered some sort of medical issue that allowed him to leave that bar under an intoxicated state, and then he doesn't know who he is? Does that make sense? Like an amnesia type thing. Sure. But there's no history of that I know of that I see in any of his medical records or anything to that. And if that was the case, I believe that you would still see him leaving on his own accord on the camera going down the escalator. And you don't see that. So now we're looking inside the bar. What happened inside that bar? Clint, his buddy, refused to take a polygraph. Now, does that bother me? Yes, on the surface. But once you get through that, it doesn't bother me. I would want to know more about Clint. Not certainly criminal history and propensity to violence. Did he fight? What were his relationship with Brian? Things like that. But what I'm more interested in, I guess, is his attitude towards police. Because that could be simply why he doesn't want to take a polygraph. He says he said everything he had to say, and that was it. Okay. But it reminds me a little bit of the Ray Rivera case. If you haven't watched that, please go and watch that. Where his buddy acted really strange afterwards and failed to take a polygraph and stuff. But let me tell you why I don't think Clint is involved. And I know Brian's brother had been kind of vocal about Clint, saying that he talked disparagingly, maybe negatively a little bit about Brian. And the aftermath of this, and that could simply be because of Brian's disappearance, it put a lot of focus on Clint. He was kind of the last person to see him. Now, what does draw a red flag to me on this is that there was an alleged verbal altercation, and I don't know what about, between Clint and Brian that night. Well, I want to know when that night that took place, what it was about, who witnessed it. Did Clint say this? Did he bring that up on his own accord, or was it witnessed by somebody else? Yes, those are all red flags for a suspect in Clint. But what I see that I do not believe Clint was involved is the time frame. The time frame that is indicated, time stamped on the surveillance video. You have at 1:50, Brian talking to these two girls in front of security guards, who are minding their own business, as you can see in the photo. They're just doing their job there. But then at 2 o'clock, 10 minutes later, you have Clint leaving with Meredith. So if you believe that Clint was involved, he would have to have done something within that 10-minute time frame. Very unlikely. Very unlikely. You're telling me not only would he have to, quote-unquote, kill him, he would have to dispose of a body within 10 minutes inside an establishment where there's hundreds of people? Very unlikely. So I think we can rule Clint out, in my opinion. Now, that could change if I seen something else. But when you have hard evidence, like a timeline, video, yeah, you know, obviously Meredith would be somebody that, and I'm sure they talked to her. I'm almost positive what her attitude was, what she said. I'd like to know that. But even without her testimony, her knowledge, I still think because of the time frame, because of the video, you could rule Clint out of being involved. So now that we've deduced that, what happened to Brian, right? I come to find out there is another exit inside the bar. Now, I've searched for photographs of this exit, and I couldn't find any. I found some fake ones, or not fake, but false ones. And that's the problem with looking at web sleuth things. They're not always correct, all right? They'll do pictures up and say, circle, and say, this is the construction exit, when it's not. Okay, so you got to be careful what you look at. But from the investigator's own words, he said there was another exit that only the staff used. That was, I believe, the kitchen area. And that led to a construction area. To me, not only is this possible, this is probable. Again, it would go back to the intoxication level that I would want to know. I find it very hard to believe any foul play took place inside that bar. Yes, I know the bar was letting out. It's 2 o'clock, but there's still a lot of people in there. And let's say there was 10 people. That's it. And I believe there was probably a lot more. But let's just say 10. You're going to tell me that a murder occurred or an accidental death inside that bar with 10 people and not one person would come forward. Not one. All of them are evil. All of them will just want to hush, hush. No, I don't believe it works like that. So what I think you can rule out that foul play happened inside that bar. Sure, you can look at employees, and you must. You have to interview everybody there. But again, you have to get possibilities to probabilities, okay? He never made it home. We've established that. We've established that Clint didn't have enough time to do anything wrong. We've established that foul play couldn't have took place inside that bar. So what's left? The construction exit. That's it. That's the only thing left. I think that is more probable than anything. So once we establish that, then what happens to him, right? Well, if he exits through the kitchen, and it probably wasn't intentional. I got to digress here and tell a short story about how when I was in Las Vegas with my best friend, we became pretty inebriated. And I knew what I was doing. I wasn't to the point where I didn't. But maybe my judgment wasn't all the best. And we've all been there, right? Well, most of us. There's some people that haven't. And good for you. But the people that have know what I'm talking about. And guess where we exited? Through the kitchen. Went right through the kitchen. Nobody, it was 2 o'clock in the morning. Nobody was there. And we went out the kitchen exit. No alarms went off. I don't know why we did it. I don't know how we did it. I just know we did it. When you have experiences like that, it leads you to a more probable explanation sometimes, if that is a possibility. And here it is. I could see him being intoxicated enough where he exits through the kitchen. Right off the bat, that sounds a little hokey, right? Or a little, I don't know. Just doesn't seem right. But when you start eliminating everything else, when you know he did not exit that front where he came in, that's the only possibility. Now you got to know whether he exited there on his own accord, whether he was forced, whether he was carried out as a lifeless body. But I think we've eliminated all that. At least in my mind, I have. So the only thing left is for him to exit out through that door on his own accord, probably intoxicated. Now, one of the things that I considered is the last people that he's seen talking to, two girls, did they have boyfriends inside? It's a possibility. And they saw that and they got angry. But again, if there was an altercation that happened inside that bar, you would have witnesses. You would. I don't care what anybody says. You would have witnesses. So, I don't believe that. I believe he must have exited to that construction area. Now, what happens after that? Now, that's where the guessing game starts. And that is where I don't have an answer for. You know, I can get you, in my mind, through deduction and possibilities to probabilities that he went out that door. But again, I think we rule out the runaway scenario. I don't believe he exits out there and decides, I'm just going to wander away. I'm not going to go get my car. I'm not going to go home, get clothes. I'm not going to empty money from my bank account. I'm just going to walk away. That is very rare. It has happened at once. I believe Michelle Whitaker, one of my videos, if you go back and watch that, that's exactly what she did. She just left. And everybody thought she was dead. And she wasn't. But different backgrounds, very vast different backgrounds between the two. So I think in my mind, I'm ruling that out. What I can't rule out and what I can't deduce after that is an accidental death or a homicide. Or you have to put in suicide there once he leaves that bar. Is he depressed enough to commit suicide? I don't believe that. The reason I don't believe that is because he's in good spirits. And I will be the first to tell you, when you imbibe alcohol and you're intoxicated, your mood can switch like that. He gets separated from his friends. He could have been depressed and started thinking about his mom, but there's no indication of suicide. Now, that doesn't mean there wasn't, because I've worked on cases like that a lot, where it was a clear-cut suicide, but parents and family said there's no way they wouldn't do that. There was no suicide note, but it was. But wouldn't his body have been found? Where is he going to go commit suicide, and what's he going to do? He doesn't have access to a weapon. It's just not possible. So I can rule that out. So that leaves accidental death or foul play. Again, hey, listen, it's always possible, right, that he ran away. It's possible. For me, it's just not probable. Accidental death, I think his body would have been found. Let's say he's walking along, he falls in a hole in a construction site. I'd want to talk to the construction workers. I'd take pictures of the area. You know, is there holes dug? The next day, wouldn't the construction people say, hey, there's a guy that died because he's out in the elements. It was too cold. He froze. He whatever it was, he fell in a ditch. They would call police. They're not just going to bury him, right, with heavy equipment. No. So I believe that you can almost rule out accidental. And you're left with one very glaring scenario. And that is, he met foul play after he left that bar. How did that occur? I don't know. Could have been a robbery. Somebody could have tried to rob him on the way home. I would want to know the statistics on the crime rate in that area. I know it's a college campus, I believe, and it's Ohio. So, I mean, it's very possible. He was, 6 foot two, 170 pounds. Again, victimology would tell you whether he's a fighter. What would happen if somebody approached him with a weapon and demanded his money? Would he fight? Would he give in? What would happen? I could see that scenario. Then you start thinking about disposal of a body and how that would occur. Most robberies I've seen, though, if you get robbed and you get shot on the street, you're just gone. Take the money and go. You're not taking the time to lift the guy up into a dumpster to get rid of him. But maybe it wasn't a robbery. Maybe it was a fight. Maybe he encounters two people and a fight occurs. And he's knocked down and hits his head. And, you know, maybe that. But then again, I would expect the body to be found. Okay? It's so difficult to speculate, right? But I would be I would still feel confident saying that nothing bad happened inside that bar, and it occurred after he left out that other exit. And maybe he left out that other exit with somebody. That is more probable the more I think about it. I mean, let's consider that for a minute. Man, I know that at closing time is when people hook up. But he has a girlfriend. Again, I'd want to know victimology. Is he the type of person that is faithful or not? How long he was with this girl? He was supposedly going to propose to her on this trip that he was leaving on. But again, with alcohol, hey, things are not always as they seem. You do not always make the best judgments. But why would they leave through that way? Through the kitchen exit? And I believe it was the kitchen exit. There was certainly a staff exit. And I believe that's also where the band exited. There was a band playing that night. And he did like music. Had a Pearl Jam tattoo. It's possible that he left out that with one of the band, but wouldn't somebody of the band's entourage or members of the band come forward and say, hey, listen, yeah, that guy left out there with us. So I can't see him leaving with a group of people. I can see him leaving either by himself or with somebody. But again, why out that exit? Now, what bothers me, though, is that law enforcement said it's possible we missed him leaving out that front. That bothers me. How is that possible? I want to know. I don't see how that can be missed. But if they're saying that's a possibility, you have to look into that. But regardless, let's say they did miss him going out the front on camera. He still never made it home, right? So he still either left on his own accord, and I think we have ruled that out. So it's accidental or foul play, whether he left out the back door or he left out the front door. You have to consider the weather in a lot of cases on missing persons like this, because people die of exposure. Now, this was April, so I doubt in Ohio. I know it still gets cold in April, but it shouldn't be enough that he, and plus his body would be found, right? There's no mountains. He's not going to stumble off into the mountain. Now, I heard, and this is one of those theories that, you know, people sometimes just want to throw theories out there. No matter how ridiculous they are. And in this case, it's pretty ridiculous that he went into the bathroom and he changed up and disguised himself and left out the front. Why? Where would he get this change of clothing? Well, he's going to borrow it from somebody? Did he have it under, you know, his clothing, have this all planned? No. That's not even a possibility, let alone a probability. Okay? Don't interject stupid theories just to throw out different theories because you can't make sense of what happened. You try to keep it simple, the most reasonable. Sometimes I get that. There isn't a simple explanation. But don't cloud it with stupidity. Somebody else, I think, there was a theory brought forth that he walked to a river and drowned. Again, how far away is this river? Okay. I will say that is a possibility, depending upon how close it is. But the probability of that, I would say, is probably pretty low. It hurts us. It hurts our ego when you don't have an answer. When you can't come up with a solution, that's why you start jumping to all these different scenarios. And I try not to do that. You deduce, okay? To me, he met foul play. Accidental death. Okay, let's talk about that. Let's say it doesn't matter whether he exits the back door or the front door. Okay? He did. Okay, he did one of those two things. There's no doubt about that. His body is not still in that bar, laying in the bathroom. He's not behind a wall somewhere in that bathroom. He's not in a kegerator in the basement. Okay? He left that bar. He did not get struck down by aliens inside that bar. Okay? Yes, it's a mystery because we don't see it. But it had to have occurred. He either went out the back door or he went out the front door. Okay? Camera either missed it or we didn't see it if he went out the back door. But one of them happened and then foul play occurred. Now, if it was an accidental death, let's say he's walking home, he gets hit by a car. Certainly a possibility. Then maybe, yeah, maybe you would leave the body there. But there's also been cases where they've taken the body with them and disposed of them when they got home. That's a possibility. Now, I know they checked cameras from other areas. And again, it was 2006, so cameras were not quite as prevalent or of good quality as they are today. But that's still foul play. That's not necessarily an accidental death. Just because it's not premeditated, the guy didn't say, I'm going to go drive down the road here and hit somebody and kill him. It's still foul play. That is certainly a possibility. He left that bar. He left the bar. It's what happened to him after that. Because cell phone records are certainly important. And I have down here that at 2:10 a.m., Clint did text him. Now, is Clint doing that to set up an alibi? Hey, I didn't do anything. Look, I was trying to get a hold of him. Sure. But I think we ruled him out based on the timeline. Now, this is certainly a possibility. Let's say let's say Brian left that bar, whether side exit, kitchen exit, or front. And he does hook back up with Clint. Okay, now him not taking a polygraph and things were the established timeline of 1:50 a.m. talking to the girls and 2 a.m. when I say Clint leaves? And it's impossible for something to happen in those 10 minutes inside the bar, so Clint is ruled out? Yes. But if they hook back up, well then, yes, Clint has to be a suspect, okay? That is certainly a possibility. Certainly a possibility. I didn't think about that until I started sitting here talking about it. Let's say Clint and Meredith leave. Brian is pissed off. He can't find them. Now, I don't know. I think he only lived a couple blocks away, but he has to walk home or whatnot. And instead of walking home, because we believe, you know, at least I do, then he never made it there. Could he have walked to Clint's? Cell phone records would tell you some things, but maybe there was no call. Maybe Brian didn't use his phone. Maybe his phone was dead. And he just walked to Clint's house. Maybe Clint's house was closer. Maybe he ran into Clint on the street getting a ride. And then there's words, or they go back to his place, and then something happens there. That is a very distinct possibility. I mean, I certainly would want to know what Clint had to say in his interview. Apparently, from what I gather, the last he saw him was in that bar at 2 o'clock. That might not be the case. Okay? Again, Brian left that bar. Is it a possibility that he would go back with Clint? Yes. Now, Clint not taking that polygraph bothers me a little bit more. Now, him talking negatively about Brian, according to his brother, bothers me a little bit more. So I would be focusing in on Clint and his background, his cell phone records. I'm sure the police did all that. I'm sure they did. So, a lot of scenarios. But I think we've deduced it enough to know that something happened and Brian left that bar. And what it is, I don't know. Crime statistics will, you know, tell you whether, again, a possibility of a robbery, yes, but I think we can throw that out because I don't think they would hide a body. You're not in a rural area. You're not in a mountainous area. You're in the city. Most bodies are going to be found. 6'2", 170 pounds, one person putting a dead body into a dumpster, very difficult. Very difficult. Two people, it's very difficult. So if you look at that through probabilities and possibilities, I would say, yeah, it's possible, but it's probably not probable. To me, he probably left that bar and made it to somebody's house. Whose house would he go to? Okay, victimology will tell you that. When he got drunk, did he just go with strangers? When he was tired and drunk, would he walk home? Would he get a taxi? Would he just go to the closest friend's house? You don't know who he ran into on the street when he left. It could have been somebody, an acquaintance of his, could have been a friend of his, and he decided to go to their house. Once they're at that house, argument takes place, foul play ensues. Or, again, I don't know his victimology. You have to look at it. Maybe there was an overdose. Maybe, and again, his victimology would tell you that. Did he do drugs? If the answer is no, okay, when he got intoxicated, would he consider it? No, okay, well then we can rule that out. But until then, until you don't know, you have to consider it a possibility. Overdose, and they decide, you know, I'm going to get rid of the body. I had a case that I worked for a family, the exact same scenario. But this guy was a heroin user. He was recovering, but he relapsed. And he OD'd. And they took him like 200 miles away and buried him in a forest. And out of sheer luck, his body was recovered. So you have to look at that. Of all the scenarios and all the possibilities, to me, that is the most probable. He left and went to somebody's house where some sort of foul play occurred. And they got rid of the body. That makes the most sense to me. That just, after we start deducing everything else, remember, it's always starting up here with everything. And then you deduce from the possibility to probabilities. And you do that by ruling things out. You start crossing them off. And we did that, and I explained that. So to me, that makes the most sense. Now, whose house he went to? I don't know, but victimology would get you that much closer. It would tell you whether he would go to a stranger's house. He's not going to be abducted. He's not going to be kidnapped. There's no reason for that. He probably went to an acquaintance's house. Possible a stranger's house. Again, victimology will tell you. I keep saying it because it's true. Could have went to Clint's house and something bad happened there. That's what I see, okay? I researched this case for about 5 hours. The people that researched this for years, especially the police officers, the investigators, they know a hell of a lot more than I do, okay? Hopefully, I can just give these suggestions that make sense, that you can go back and say, okay, yeah, that makes sense. Let's look in this direction. Hopefully they did that. But you got to be willing to think outside the box, which is important, but you don't want to build a whole new colony of boxes. You know what I mean? You look outside the box, but don't start going crazy and start coming up with spy stuff and changing clothes and purposely to avoiding the cameras. You're just building more boxes that have more bullshit in them that people who are investigating have to weed through. Yes, you have to consider all possibilities. I get that. But make sure those possibilities are reality-based. Okay? I get comments all the time, and sometimes they're just so outlandish. Because you try to make sense, because your ego tells you, hey, I can't figure it out, so let's just start throwing out outlandish possibilities. It's not how you solve cases, folks. Period. End of story. So, I'm going to go over my notes just to make sure that I didn't miss something that I wanted to miss or talk about. We went through the timeline. I think the timeline's good. The back door to the construction site, I'd still want to know more about that. The verbal altercation with Clint. Again, if he leaves out that back door or the front door and it's missed and he hooks back up with Clint, maybe the altercation again takes place. He brings it up. You know how it is when you're drinking, you know. Sometimes people won't let something go. It was said, maybe it stewed in him. And maybe that's the reason they split up inside that bar. Maybe it wasn't because it was so crowded and they just lost. Clint texting him at 2:10. Maybe Brian didn't answer because he didn't want to answer. Maybe because he was pissed at him. that altercation, I'd want to know more about it and what it was about. You know, if it was just something about, hey, your football team sucks, I like the Eagles, I like the Steelers, yeah, well, you know, screw you. Okay, I still want to know that. That's not a recipe for murder, although I have seen people get murdered for less. I want to know what that is about, that altercation. Somebody knows. The cell phone ping. Okay, so there was... Brian's girlfriend continued to call his cell phone. And I guess about 3 weeks or some time after, it was always going to voicemail. And at some point, it rang. And people said, well, that shows that Brian's alive. No, it doesn't. Okay, rule that out right away. It was just a glitch in the cell phone. Cell phone company acknowledged that. All right, that's all it was. I want to address that after Brian's dad died, which was a few years, I want to say, after, it might have been 2018. That sticks to me for some reason, but maybe not. At some point, Brian's dad died. He got hit by a tree in a storm. And his online memorials, somebody wrote, I love you, Dad, Brian, from Virgin Islands. And police followed up that tip, and it was a hoax. I can't explain to you how angry that makes me. Now, I am glad his mom and his dad were both not able to see that post because of the hurt that it would cause them. But his brother was still alive, and his family and friends are still alive. Much like the Sherry Joe Bates case where it was proven to be a hoax that somebody wrote Bates must die. Not the confession letter, I've come to learn. It was the Bates must die, and it was a hoax. And it was a. They had sent that to her dad. People, I don't know how to explain it. The people that do this, that do these hoaxes, I don't know whether to feel sorry for them because they are obviously missing something in their life that they have to do this. I tried to be an intelligent, respectful person and look at things through everybody's eyes. I find that important. You know, I used to do that when I'd arrest drug dealers. I look things through their eyes and see, you know, their lifestyle and, you know, how they were brought up and why they do what they do. But in this case, people that do this, I can't act intelligent. I can't see things through their eyes. I really would just love to be in a room with them for about 3 minutes alone with no cameras, and we would have a man-to-man discussion. Now, I often think about that with trolls. Some of these people who write very mean and disparaging comments to me. And it used to bother me to the point where I would really get angry. And I want to handle things my way. And I've gotten over that with trolls because I realized they don't matter. I'm not going to let them ruin my day. I guarantee 99% of them would not say it to my face. And the reason the 1% would be to sue me after I beat the piss out of them. So I've learned to not let trolls bother me. But the people that victimize the victims' families again and again by doing something like this, that still bothers me, because you're the lowest form of life on earth. These people have already gone through enough, and you just find it cute or funny to do that. I'd love to slap the shit out of you anytime anybody ever did that. And I hope someday somebody will. Now, with that said, let's go back to Happy Kenny and tell you that the last thing I wrote here is that he never made it home. And I think we all can agree on that. My final judgment, from what I see, is he left that bar and went to somebody's house. And that's where foul play ensued and body was hidden. That's what it tells me. Could be wrong. He could be out there living on the beach, drinking a margarita, hanging out with senoritas, living the Bob Marley lifestyle, but I doubt it. I hope that is the case for him and his family. But unfortunately, I think like so many others, this ended in foul play at somebody's house and he left that bar. So with that said, hey, that was my look at Brian Shaffer. And I saw the Elvis movie a couple days ago. It was awesome. Loved it. And yesterday was the 45th anniversary of Elvis's passing. And yes, he did die. Make no mistake about it. He didn't fake his own death either. You conspiracy theorists blow my mind. But I think it's funny sometimes. So with that said, hey, here's to Elvis and his family, Lisa Marie and everybody else. Condolences for that. Condolences to the Shaffer family. And if the brother, you know, wants to talk to me, if he's got questions, I'm always available. So, hey, with that said, Mains out.